So today's lecture, we will put electrons in periodic potential. Electrons in periodic potentials. Remember that in real crystal, there is a periodic array of positive ions. There is a periodic array of positive ions. And when there's a positive array for electron, it's an attractive potential that is coming from each positive ion. So you have some kind of a Coulombic attractive potentials from each positive ions. Right? And then this is easily approximated with sine wave. Potential something like sine waves. That's the sort of potential electron feels when electron travels in the crystal. So it feels periodic attractive force and the repulsive force. Okay? And to solve this problem, actually I will give you homework to work on the sine electrons in sinusoidal potential. But in a lecture, to make this story much easier, we will use this type of a box potential. Yeah. Instead of sinusoidal, you know, electron will go through this type of a box potential. Okay? And to solve this problem, we have to start from something simple. So we will actually cut out something like one part and work on how electron goes through this one potential barrier. Okay? Someone with the quantum mechanics, you've probably taken quantum mechanics courses, have gone through this, but I have to go through this again. Okay? But this potential, it's just the question is how electron moves through this potential. And this potential can actually make it into two parts. One is just potential going up, and the other is potential going down. Okay? So we will work on, let's say, which problem first? This problem first. And then this problem next. And then we will move on to this problem, and then try to solve this problem. And the homework will be this problem. So it's just, you know, additive. Okay? That's our plan. So we start with a step potential. Step potential. We define the coordinate. This is position x, and this position is 0. Okay? And this is energy or potential. And this potential is 0, and this potential is V naught. Okay? And so this is like a, or I can also say this is Vx, some kind of potential. This region extends forever to the minus infinity. And this region goes all the way to positive infinity. And we will actually consider two cases. One is this case. Electron coming in from the left has energy, or you know, energy meaning that the kinetic energy smaller than this B naught. So that's a one case. And for the convenience of solving this problem, we will divide into two regions. Region one is left to this barrier, and region two is right of this x equals zero. Okay? So, and to make the story complete, Bx is zero for x smaller than zero, and that's V naught again for x zero, basically. Okay? Okay, case one. So case one. When energy coming in is smaller than V naught, this is a case. Okay. For this case in region one, remember, we always have this simple wave function. Go zero. And of course, in this case, K equals to square root of 2m e over h square. Okay. And solution to this is a e exponential I kx plus B exponential minus IKX. So that's 4x smaller than zero. So after all, we are trying to come up with what we call the steady state solution. Steady state solution means we have some wave here. I will give you the answer first. You know, what is going to be the answer? The final answer is going to be something like this. This is something we're going to get at the end, right? So I'll tell you what it is first. This is easier than trying to make it too mysterious. So here, we have the wave coming in from the left to right, and it is reflected here, so it goes right to left. And somehow, it's making steady state, just sinusoidal wave with energy. And then inside the barrier, there is some probability for the electron to penetrate into the wall. That's the idea. If this is a hard tennis ball, the ball will bounce back at the wall. So it will never go in. But because electron is also a wave, the wave can penetrate, right? I mean, you know, the light is coming through. There are lots of small things, even though glass is transparent, there are lots of impurities. But wave is long enough that it just comes through, right? Right? The wave doesn't see that there's obstacles. The wave in the ocean doesn't see small, I don't know, insects or something, fish. If the fish stops everything, that's another great story, but you know, it doesn't see small things because it has a wavelength. But for the similar reason, it just goes penetrate into this barrier a little bit and it goes back. There are many features, specific features. First of all, penetrate meaning that after all, the wave function gives you the probability of finding an electron at a certain point. That means there is some probability of finding an electron at x equals this point. But this is exponentially decaying. So it's exponential decay, so it goes on forever. So even far away, there is very tiny probability of finding an electron, but it's really small. The other interesting feature, important feature, is that you see the wave is continuous here, right? It's not abrupt. It's continuous. And this is a very important sort of like a rule or intuition that we have to, physics rule that we have to follow. Okay? So this is something that we're trying to reach at the end of this, you know, exercise. So inside, to the left of that, we have wave coming from left to right, positive K, and we have negative K, and both wave coming from this way and wave coming from this way, they add up together to form a standing wave. And region two, right of that, the wave function becomes minus kappa, this is kappa, Greek letter, kappa square equals to zero. And here, kappa is 2m h square v naught minus e square root. So the difference between v naught and e, so it's right here. It's right here. If the difference is V naught, there's no, it goes zero, right? And wave function in this case is given by x equals to C e exponential kappa x plus d exponential minus kappa x for x now we don't have minus i we don't have I anymore. You see, we have moving wave, propagating waves in this case. Not for this case, because it is just damping exponentially. And for this to damp exponentially, we have to throw away this term, because this is just diverging exponentially. Right? So we just say, this is physically wrong. You know, this is, you know, that's what physicists see all the time. By inspection, this is wrong. So we set C equals zero. C equals zero. And once, because after all, this, basically, if we have this diverges, so to be more precise, this term diverges at x to infinity, unless c equals zero. Okay? So that's, you know, we cannot allow this function to diverge in a positive infinity. So now we have a set of equations to work with. One is that we have equals to A E I K X plus B E minus I K X for X and D E minus kappa X for X So we need to solve this. And the boundary condition is that boundary conditions, boundary conditions at x equals zero, both wave function itself and also slope of wave function must be continuous. Continuous. In other words, what is the first part? Here's a wave coming from left to right. And wave has to be continuous. It cannot be something like this. It cannot be something like this. This is discontinuous, even though I intentionally made slope continuous, right? Also, this cannot be like this. The slope has to be continuous. So it has to have a same slope from left to right and right to left to damp exponentially, right? So those are the two conditions. So let's insert x equals zero here to these equations. The top one, this one, x equals zero, so this is one, so a plus b at x equals zero should be equal to d. right? A plus B equals to D. This condition is continuous. For this, for this to be continuous, we have to have, we have to take a first derivative of this and insert x equals 0. So first derivative of this, and that's basically, we are going to have ik, that's a minus b, equals minus capital D. Right? Just take a first derivative of this. Minus kappa comes out, and then put 0 here, so it's a minus capital D. And if we put them all together, A is going to be I plus I K, sorry, kappa K D V That's what happens if we put them together. So, B over A becomes 1 minus I kappa So that's a typical. You see why I want to have B over A. And D over A, D over A is, I think it's 2, 1 plus I kappa K equals to 1. Sorry. I'm writing something. Wow. Let me. Sorry. And then let me define E over A as a exponential I alpha, where alpha is 2 tangent minus 1 minus V naught over E minus 1 square root. Yeah, this is more realistic. And D over A is 1 plus I kappa k equals to 1 plus I alpha. And if I put them all together, two A exponential I alpha 2 cosine kx minus 4x and 2a e I alpha over 2 cosine 2 alpha e exponential minus I cap on x for x that larger than 0. So at the end, we get to the expression that one expression, which is just a, you know, some kind of a cosine wave, stable. The other expression, which is dominated by this decaying term, which is this part. So usually, what we draw is that if I draw function kx, what we get is something like this. Something like this. Imagine that if this is a real periodic potential, whose potential stops here. Here, another wave starts to propagate, right? And this is something that we're going to have in a real periodic potential. But we just have to start from a very simple thing first. Why do I have B over A and D over A? B over A gives you so-called reflectivity. Remember? After all, what is B? B is, after all, it was the wave function. I shouldn't have erased it, but we have something like A for, right? So A is the amplitude of wave going from left to right. And B is the amplitude of the wave going from right to left. So the ratio of A and B gives you reflection coefficient. How much reflectivity you get. So for this, let me define reflectivity. What's the maximum value of reflectivity? One means full reflection. No wave going in. Reflectivity one is all the wave is reflected. Okay? And the reflectivity is, for example, given by R is V what's the right word? Here, reflectivity is given by two things. One is the velocity. Velocity of the wave, I meant incident wave. So the velocity of the wave coming in, and A is the amplitude of the wave coming in from left to right. And VR is a reflected wave. So velocity of the wave going right to left, and B is the amplitude of the wave going right to left. Here, velocity coming in and going out is the same. Remember, because after we all have same K. K means, you know, wave vector. So this, after all, in this case, VR and VI are the same, so this is one. So it is just given by, simply by amplitude ratio of the square root square of the amplitude. You'll see how this velocity becomes important in the next problem. Next example. Okay. So we're done with this first simple example. So we move on to the next problem. So maybe I should actually draw the diagram first. Ah, wait a minute. I forgot to work on the other problem. Sorry. It's keep the same. I still have to work on this, work on the same problem, but different case. It's a V0, 0. I have to work on the next case where energy is larger than V0. Okay, I forgot about that. Okay? So, now the energy of the wave is electrons higher than potential. This is in a classical physics sense. This is very strange because, you know, if the airplane is flying, and if there's a mountain or something underneath, if the electron gets reflected, that's a big problem, right? But you know, in quantum mechanically, because this is wave, it can feel the change in the potential underneath. So we will see that. Okay, so we will see this. So this is a case two, where energy is larger than V0 potential. Okay. For x smaller than 0, we have So now the difference is that we have two different k's. On the right hand side, so it's a region 2, region 2, 2, region 1. We have different k because k prime 0 width. Now k prime is given by this part, of course, is the same, 2m over 8 squared, but with e minus v naught. So, on the right hand side, the energy, kinetic energy, is only this much. Kinetic energy is only this much. Okay. So the equation becomes A epsilon. Okay, so we have to have, of course, k prime. This is important to make the difference. But now we come back here and, you know, make the inspection again. We always like to inspect. So there's a wave coming in. Classically, there's no wave going back. But let's just say this is quantum mechanical thing. So wave coming in and there's wave going back by reflection, by change of this potential. Okay? So there's a wave coming in, A, and there's wave going back because of the reflection at x equals 0. Coming in, coming back. Once wave goes through, is there any cause or reason for this wave to be reflected again? Is there one? No. This potential just stays the same forever. That means once wave is transmitted, it will never encounter any change in potential. That means there's no wave coming back in region 2. So, based on this inspection, we say d equals 0. And we throw away this term. Because if this is a wave going from right to left in region 2. Then we are going to solve this with the boundary condition. Boundary conditions. Continuous. This is continuous. That means we insert 0, 0, 0. So A plus B equals to C. We also say slope is also continuous. And if that's the case, we say, okay, pull this out for the derivative, and then we get something like K A minus B equals to K prime C. So therefore, we get B over A equals to K minus K prime, K plus K prime, C over A equals to 2K, K plus K prime. So that's B over A. B over A defines reflectivity, and C over A actually sort of gives the transmission coefficient. But let's, in order for us to discuss reflection coefficient and transmission coefficient, let's just define current J. J is given by V A square minus B square in x equals 0, and B prime C square in x. Now we have two velocity. You know, after all, current means current. I'm going through this way. Velocity is important. Faster the electron, the more you get current. Also, what is amplitude? Amplitude is the probability of finding electrons. So that's like, you know, that corresponds to like a concentration. Larger A means more electron going in than more, I should say, portion of the electron going in than portion of one electron going back. Also, velocity is given by h bar k over m, remember? Because the h bar k is like a momentum, so this is like mv. And velocity v is given by h bar k prime over m. So, if we do V minus V, B This corresponds to reflection coefficient plus transmission coefficient, which is 1. Okay. So this is a reflection coefficient. And this is a transmission coefficient. And what is important, sorry, this is not V prime, this is just V. That's the important thing, right? Okay? So this is same, but these are not same. That's the difference. Okay? So R is given by, at the end, B square A square remember it was K minus K prime square K plus K prime square, which is given by 1 minus So now I'm going to, because of this relations, I'm going to plot R as a function, reflectivity as a function of the E over V naught. So why is E over V naught important? You know, after all, I said this is quantum mechanical. So, wave going far above this V naught can be affected by change in the potential underneath. But the question is, how much this can be affected? You know, it cannot be affected so much, right? But if this is so close, it can be affected very much. So I will just give you ballpark value of reflectivity. This is 1. So this is 100% reflection. We start from 1, of course, because you know when we have this, it goes in, but it always comes back. But it's very small portion goes on forever, but it's extremely small. It's exponential, so there is some small element going forever. So practically speaking, it starts from 1 until this reaches 1. This reaches 1 meaning that it's all 1 if the energy is high, and when incident energy becomes same as V0, then all of a sudden, above there, everything goes through, almost 100%, but not quite. And this is why at 1, you get some drop exponentially. And at above 2, the reflection is so small. Above 2 means if the electron energy is 2 times taller than this barrier height, then even though there is some reflection, you hardly get reflections. Okay? So in the next 15 minutes or so, I will actually let you work 15 or 10 minutes or whatever. I will let you work on the other problem. Why don't you try to solve a problem which looks like this? Right? It's zero, V naught. There's only one case one. There's no case two. There's no wave coming in from left with energy lower than barrier. It is only, so there's only one case. The wave comes in with energy E. And this energy is on the right hand side, E plus V naught, right? There's only one case. But still, even though the potential is going down, there's actually some probability of getting reflected here. The solution, which was here, is very similar. A plus A exponential ikx plus B exponential minus ikx. And right-hand side is C exponential ikx minus D exponential ikx. But D is zero. Because once wave is through, there's no potential change. Okay? So you can solve this. But I'm actually going to take a little break. So now we're going to do this real electron in a so we will consider Vx and here we have potential. This is A minus P naught. Now this is zero. And okay, I will use white for the potential. Zero P naught A, and this is B minus A. This position is A, zero. This position is zero. This position is B, and so on. Okay, oh sorry, this is minus B naught. Minus B naught, zero. This is just x. So first I'm going to define block waves. So what I'm trying to say right now is that I have one wave function, which is a summation, which is described by summation of two wave functions. Okay? In fact, as I showed you already, one wave function can be, described by addition of many wave functions. When I talk about wave packet was constructed by adding many plane waves, right? So it's the same idea. But to understand the property of so-called walk wave, which we will reach in 20 minutes or so, we need to assume that one wave function is given by linear combination of number of, you know, multiple number of wave functions. In this case, two. Okay? And if this is a solution, then if this is a solution to one particular wave function, then I can say that psi x plus a x plus a is also a solution to the wave function, because we now have a periodic potential. Periodic potential of the periodicity a, right? So this is like a translational vector, a real space vector, you know, of the Bradley lattice. So displacement by a, which is a periodicity of this lattice, brings you to this exactly same, I wouldn't say same wave function, but it's a displacement by a should also be a solution to the wave function. And that's, if you actually accept this, then you get x plus a equals to a11, it's an element. Then because this is also a solution, these are also a solution of the wave function, we are going to insert two into one. Once we insert two into one, what we get is here I said D1, D2 because it stands for determinant. D1, D2 goes as element and we want to diagonalize this element. We want to diagonalize the element. We take the determinant a11 minus lambda A, 1, 2, A, 2, 1, A, 2, 2, minus lambda, equals to 0. And if we solve this, we get lambda. We have two lambdas, right? Lambda 1 and lambda 2. Basically, this is a second order equation. So we get two lambdas for the solution. And if C1 and C2, excuse me, C1 and C2 are eigen vectors, corresponding to the eigen values lambda 1 and lambda 2, D1 equals to lambda C1, and D2 equals lambda C2. Because, you know, after all, it comes from here. We have to connect D1 with the C1, D2 with C2, and if lambda here is given by lambda 1 and lambda 2 are eigenvalues, then C1 and C are eigenvalues, eigenvectors corresponding to these lambdas, then we get the relation like that. So and for it's okay if you don't understand the details, but you know, I just want to get to the end, and at the end something simple comes out. So you just have to stay here. Okay. So for all solutions, this is important not to make a mistake here. Only those with this condition is satisfying the condition. I should say only two wave functions satisfy the condition this. So for all solutions of this wave function, only two wave functions satisfy the condition x plus a equals to lambda psi x, which means satisfying the periodic condition. And because of this, we get x plus ma equals to, it's just, I put n, so I put n on the shoulder of lambda, m psi x. And here n equals 0 plus minus 1 plus minus 2. Okay, and then now we have this. For energy E, corresponding to eigenvalues lambda 1 and lambda 2 of 3. 3 is this one. We just, this actually, basically the whole story is actually in the Ashcroft Merman. This development is based on Ashcroft Merman, but I just have a few more lines. So, and then moreover, let me define derivative of equation, wave function, derivative of wave function. And if this is the case, then Wronskian is defined by lambda 1 prime and Wronskian x plus a equals lambda 1, lambda 2, Wronskian x and because the solution, I told you that there are two solutions here. Because they also, Wronskian of those are also corresponding to the energy E of eigenvalues. We can say that lambda 1, lambda 2 equals to 1. So if you just go through all the conditions that lambda is a, there's a solution for the wave function lambda 1 and corresponding to lambda 1 and lambda 2, and these are eigenvalues of corresponding to energy E, and that Wronskian is also the solution of the wave function. I'm sorry, I'm losing you, but there's a, the condition that lambda 1, lambda 2 equals to 1 have to be met. Once you accept that, we just need to know, what lambda 1 and lambda 2 are. But we know that lambda 1 times lambda 2 equals to 1. There's already a hint. And if lambda 1 is larger than 1, there's equation 4. And if the lambda 1 is larger than 1, this diverges, this function diverges in a plus infinity. So that's no good. So lambda has to be, if this is the case, then wave function diverges, for as x goes to infinity. And that's no good. And also it converges as x goes to minus infinity. That's no good either. So if that's the case, then simply lambda 1 equals lambda 2 equals 1. So if we set lambda 1 equals E I K A and if we set lambda 1 and lambda 2 as shown here, this is positive, no minus here, then what we get is that if we set it like this, then we get all wave function lambda psi, we get all psi wave function for only by evaluating the region minus pi over a k pi over a. And this means x plus ma equals to exponential I n k a whatever that means, it's a Bloch's conditions. Okay. And then if we put, say, okay, finally I got Brough theorem. And what does this mean? After all these some development, we get to this simple formula, Brough theorem. What does it mean? Well, let's look at the first part. This part in Brough theorem, this equation. This equation just simply means there's a plane wave. There's a plane wave. Right? The first part. E I K X. Second part is some modulations. Some modulation, periodic potential. And of course this periodic potential comes from ions. And this is like electron. This is potential. And Brough theorem simply says actual wave function is a multiplication of the electron wave, or I should say modulation of the electron wave by periodic potential. And very often people write something like, okay, because this is modulated by periodic potential, you get something like this. You know, the actual wave function, electron wave function, is modulated by periodic potentials. This final outcome is quite straightforward, but it's intuitively correct. But there are different ways of coming up to this point, and Ashcroft and Merman describes two different ways of deriving Brough theorem. Okay. And this was for one dimension. This was for one dimension. And we want to do this for three dimensions at the end. We want to do this for three dimensions. So to do this for three dimensions, we get 3D, we get this is a vector. vector. You see, welcome back, reciprocal translational vector. We haven't seen this for some weeks, right? Now he's back. And wave function. Translational is now exponential ik r so you know this corresponds to this one. And then this corresponds to this part. Now I'm just drawing what happened to the wave function, which has r plus translation vector. This was just an arbitrary r. Now I intentionally introduce r, arbitrary r, plus translational vector of the Bravais lattice. Translational vector of the Bravais lattice. If I introduce translational vector of the Bravais lattice, then what I get is the following. Translational vector, then I get exponential I k dot r, right? Exponential I k dot large r, that's from r plus r part, and u, I can say u r, but also because u r plus r is u r, I can also say u r. And this is this let's see, I have to be careful here. Let me write down what I have in my notebook. And I have a feeling that there's something wrong, but let me write down what I have. This has to be okay, I think this is correct. N k dot r, so it's a psi r. I know this is correct, but I find because this part and this part together makes it this. Okay, let me move on and see whether it makes sense. Okay? I'm going to also solve exactly the same problem. Slightly different way. Epsilon I k r plus large r, r plus large r, well it's okay, okay, I'm just going to copy this. Yeah, this, I guess I'm correct, so I'm just copying this here And this is exponential I k dot r and exponential I k dot r. Now we'll come back reciprocal lattice vector. And this is 1, right? By definition, remember? This is 1. This is 1, after all. This equals to 1. So I'm just inserting this. And so dot R So, what is very interesting as far as I'm concerned is that here, just compare these two. Just compare these two. These things are equal. Of course these things are equal. But these things are the same wave function. After all, this is 1. But what this says is that if we change k by large k, changing k by large k is a translational vector, reciprocal lattice vector. Translation reciprocal space by reciprocal lattice vector doesn't change the wave function at all. Meaning that moving in a reciprocal space by large k brings you to exactly same wave function. And you will see how powerful this is in later. Because once we accept this, moving k in a reciprocal lattice doesn't change anything, then we don't have to calculate everything, but we just have to calculate a few things and just translate. Okay. So this is the part I wanted to get to. So, let me move on. Let me move on, meaning that let me come back to this figure. Okay. So now, let's just consider, let's try to, once we know we have that block condition, we can try to solve the problem of electron in this crystal. Case 1. Yes, electron is somewhere above here, but below 0. Okay? So, You see, I have two different parts. I have this region. So electron in this region is decaying, but electron here is freely moving. Okay? So we have two regions. We have two regions. And here, alpha is 2m Here we have alpha and beta. And for one, this part, and one, this potential part, we have wave function, which is given by basically, this is a B, for example, B minus A. For example, this is for B minus A larger than X, larger than 0. And C E beta X plus D E minus beta x for 0 x. So we only talk about this region, or this region, right? The left region corresponds to this condition. This part corresponds to this equation. And here, we introduce Bloch theorem. So you're going to see how I'm going to do this. What if, for the region, B minus A and B, so that means the region between here. Basically, what Bloch theorem says is that, okay, we can solve the equation here, but this equation extends through the whole crystal, and it's the same wave function throughout the whole crystal. So, okay? So for this region, for here, the potential looks like this, right? Potential looks like this. For this region, we can say UK potential X is, not the potential, but this is so I'm using Bloch theorem, but you know, it just Bloch theorem originally is that this times this, right? But this now I have minus here because I moved exponential, which used to be on the left to the right, right? This is a Bloch theorem. Minus. I put minus here, so I can get U K x equals to A E I alpha minus K X plus B E minus I alpha plus K X 4 B minus A U K X equals to C E Because UKX is periodic, if I say this is equation number 5, equation 5 gives so all of a sudden, because this is periodic, we only consider this part, but because thanks to this periodic potential, and we insert this into here, allows us to consider, to conclude that this equation provides solution not only for this local region, but for the whole region. Okay? For the whole region. For example, B, where is B larger than, so maybe here, if this is A, how about this region here? What happened in this region? It's bigger than B, but smaller than A, right? It just, you know, this is just a A. So U and then X minus A plus B minus I alpha plus K X minus A. That's the potential we have. Okay. Then, for this condition, we set boundary conditions. What is the necessary boundary conditions? Boundary conditions. boundary conditions. Boundary condition is that, let's just say this potential x, and so it's a wave function, and this wave function dux it may be confusing, but this is also wave too, right? That's the confusing part. This is a periodic potential, which is bit wave. And we're also talking about wave in many aspects. Wave, and this is just another wave. So when we consider just periodic wave functions, must be continuous at x equals 0. Okay? Suddenly I come back to the simple problem. Two boundary conditions are the wave function has to be, I don't know exactly what form, but it has to be continuous at x equals 0, and also the slope has to be continuous. But the significant part of this, significance of this block function is that because these equations ensure that they are all shared by the whole crystals, thanks to the Bloch theorem, solving or satisfying boundary condition for this particular point only allows us to just satisfy, basically map out wave function for the whole crystal. You don't have to worry about wave function here, boundary condition here, boundary condition here, boundary condition here. Once you satisfy boundary condition here, it automatically satisfies here and here and here and so on, thanks to the Bloch theorem, which is a periodic. Okay, so we just need to solve this part, and you know, so this. If I say this must be continuous then what we get is one of those a plus b equals to c plus d, right? From here, a plus b equals to c plus d. And for this to be continuous, we get so these are the two conditions. Okay? So we set this here. So we set condition here, but this is not to make it completely periodic, we have to set one more boundary condition here. Then we can get the complete periodicity. So what I said is not exactly right. I have to satisfy boundary condition here and boundary condition here, and this ensures repetitions all the way. So we set boundary condition at x equals 0, but also we need to set boundary conditions at boundary conditions at x equals to b, which is here, I can write equations, but it's long and I will forfeit my game at this point. But I will just give you the answer, because otherwise I just keep writing forever. I decided to forfeit at this point. But what I said is that then you can get two boundary conditions just like those, right? And then you just need to solve for A and B and so on. And at the end, what you get is the following. At the end, what you get is the following. Cosine alpha C, C is here, C is A minus B. So C, cosine KB minus alpha square minus beta square 2 alpha beta sine alpha C sine alpha beta sine alpha beta. Okay, where am I? Sine alpha C, cosine alpha C, cosh. That's what I wrote. You see, there was something wrong. Cosh, hyperbolic cosine. And this is, I knew there's something wrong. Beta B minus alpha square minus beta square, 2 alpha B sine alpha C, hyperbolic sine beta B equals to cosine K is here. Yes. So what you get at the end is that there's some function on the left which has to satisfy simple cosine function, which is a function of Ka. K is a wave vector, right? And A is just a periodicity here. Periodicity here. By the way, this was solved by a person named Cronick and Penny. So this problem is known as a Cronick-Penny model. Cronick-Penny model, because Cronick and Penny introduced this function, and using Bloch theorem, they derived this final answer. Okay, so this was a solution for case one, which is wave function is somewhere in between here. We still have to derive a solution for case two, which wave function is above V0 energy. Okay? And I know you're getting tired. And luckily, there's a big cheating we can do. Here, we say, when we derive this, okay, let's just do this. Case two. But this is case two. E is larger than zero. Energy is larger than zero. Electron energy is larger than zero. If this is the case, beta becomes imaginary. Imaginary. Beta becomes imaginary. Beta becomes imaginary. But the cheating imaginary, and here beta equals to I k, and k is given by 2 m e h bar square. But the cheating I'm going to do right here is that when we derive this particular equation, we never say that beta is, we never assume beta is real or imaginary. So we just have to sort of plug this back to this, and then we get the answer. So we don't have to go through everything, but we just have to write down that For the case two, we get cosine alpha c equals to cosine, hyperbolic cosine, beta is now ik, right? But I don't have to worry about I, so it's a I can write down beta. B minus, cosine of C, cosine. So it's a hyperbolic, so I just KB, because now I insert I and remove the hyperbolic part. Alpha square plus beta square, 2 alpha K. Compared to this, and then sine kb equals to cosine ka. So if this is equation 6, and if this is equation 7, we need to set equation 6 and 7 are continuous. Zero. Now we move E from bottom to top, and here when we cross equals energy equals to zero, 6 and 7 needs to be continuous. So we have some function which takes form of cosine Ka. Some function, and I'm going to draw what it looks like in a real So now, I draw f is some function fe. I have this part. This part, this is 1. This is 0. This is 0. So this is minus 1. And some function looks like this. So I'm drawing some function, yes, yellow. Some function is yellow. Some function looks like this at the end. And so left-hand side is drawn by yellow. Left-hand side of this equation. Right-hand side, cosine Ka can be only between plus and minus 1. So to satisfy this equation, this condition is satisfied only this part, right? Because above 1 or below minus 1 cannot satisfy the condition shown here. So the final outcome here is that electrons in solid can take specific energy shown by red, but not the energy, like, for example, say blue or something, some different color, okay? Electrons cannot take energy here or energy here. Energy here or energy here, right? So once we put in electrons in a periodic potential, some energies are forbidden. Okay? So now, finally, this is a fun part, at least for me. After all, this is, you know, mathematically we solved this. We skipped many of the steps, but you know, let's just say we have solved this, we have reached this position. But physically, let's try to understand what is going on physically. Okay? Physically, what is happening is that we can say, let's just think about a hydrogen atom. Hydrogen atom with one electron. So it's a one proton in the middle, and where we have one hydrogen electron. We place another hydrogen here. And we place another hydrogen here. So that we make a periodic array of hydrogen, one-dimensional crystal. Okay? It's a bracket like this. Each hydrogen provides one electron. When hydrogen is far away, let me draw energy as a function of the function of A, let's say average separation between hydrogen. Okay? Average separation between hydrogen. When A is very large, what is the energy level? 1s, 2p, and 2s, and so on, right? You have hydrogenic levels. You learned this in chemistry, right? And then, what if we try to reduce the separation? As we reduce the separation, electron wave functions start to overlap. And there's a Fermi's, Pauli's exclusion principle, which says no electrons cannot take same energy, except for, you know, when you consider spins. So, as you reduce the average separation between hydrogen, you start to get this separation energy. How many separations are there? The separation is equal to the number of hydrogen in crystal, right? If there are 10 hydrogen, there are 10 separations, 10 levels. If there are infinite number of hydrogens, infinite number of separations, right? So is the 2p level, so is 2s level, right? And then there is chemically, what do you call, the energetically favorable separation distance, as we discussed before. So there's a specific A naught, which minimizes the energy to form Bravais lattice. So suddenly you see, there's an energy that can take, and then here's the blue part, energetically forbidden part, and energetically allowed part, energetically forbidden part, energetically allowed part. It's the same as that. So that's exactly the same story. So intuitively, this is easier to understand. But that's intuitively what's happening when you make things into periodic array. So you now know that this part may be continuous. Yes, it is continuous for the infinite size lattice, meaning that infinite number of hydrogen, because there are infinite points. But if it's not, then there's only n points. N is a number of hydrogen here. And here's another n points, because there's, you know, this number of allowed states is the same as number of hydrogen. Right? So there's n, n, n. You just have to turn this 90 degrees. We have... So I can try to draw something like this. I can try to draw something like this. Try to make it. part is allowed. So this part is allowed, and this part is prohibited, and this part is allowed. This part is allowed, so it's allowed here, and prohibited here, allowed here. Something like that, right? So this is a blue region. This is a blue region. Blue, and so on. Right? And also, I can draw something like this. Originally, if I draw as a function of the K, originally it has something like this. E equals h bar squared k squared 2m. Now some states are prohibited. So let's see. This state is prohibited too. I have to do this more precisely. And this part. This part is blue. So, try to have the same. K energy. And now, this part is prohibited, so the new allowed part, allowed part is only here. And next allowed part is here. Yeah? And next allowed part is here. Next allowed part is here. It's hard to draw exactly, but okay, here's something. It looks like this. It is now allowed here, allowed here, allowed here. As a function of the K. So there's a gap. I will cover this much more in detail in the next lecture, but as a final conclusion, this is also very intuitively easy. After all, if you understand the Bloch theorem, if you can accept the Bloch theorem. Remember, we have one parabolic well. Okay? I'll wait for it. You got to finish the painting. Okay? We have one parabola for the free electrons. Bloch theorem says it is okay to displace this by K, reciprocal as a vector. And then you still get exactly the same wave function, remember? So I am happy because I'm allowed to remove this, displace this by 2 pi over a, which is a reciprocal lattice vector, and then I'm happy to draw another parabola. Right? I can do the same to this side, minus 2 pi over a. Okay, I can do that. I'm allowed because of the Bloch theorem. I can move wave function by translational vector in reciprocal space, and I still get exactly the same energies. Okay? I can do 4 pi over a. I probably didn't do this right, but that's okay. I can do this here. There's something wrong, I think. But, you know, I do it anyway. Okay, I do it anyway. Okay? That's okay, close enough. There's something wrong, but that's okay. Okay, now, well, it's not that bad, after all. Now, we have to bring back all the things that we learned. We treated in this class here. What happened here at this cross section? What happened here at this cross intersects? First of all, this satisfies constructive interference conditions. It's a half of large K. Remember? This is K, half of K. And intuitively now this is easy to understand because if you take this as origin, there's a wave coming from left to right at this point. And if you take this as origin, there's a wave coming in from right to left with exactly the same K, but opposite wavelength. So here's a wave going from left to right. Here's a wave going from right to left. They meet with exactly the same wavelength, same K. So they constructively interfere to form standing waves. Standing waves means they're not propagating. They're not propagating means slope becomes zero. Slope is the speed, velocity of the wave, right? After all. Yeah? dE, dK is the velocity of that wave. So here's interference to form a standing wave. There are two energies, but I will come back to that in the next lecture. Same thing happens here. Here, you see? Here, this is the origin, wave coming in to the right to left. If this is the origin, it's a wave coming from left to right is meeting. So same thing happens here. So there's an interference. And same thing happens here. So at the end, what we get is just a simple things like this. when it all repeats with the reciprocal lattice vector k. So at the end, what is this corresponding to? Let's look at the red thing, red part. Yellow is all true, but I'm just going to highlight some of the important part. Here, 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 here. So this red part is similar to this part, right? The red part, it's hard to see. It's hard to see. So I'm going to highlight even more. You see, this red part is the same as this part. And another thing is that if you consider only this part, pi over a and minus pi over a, you can get all the information because this just repeats. So blue is this one. Blue is this one. Blue is this one. And we will later start putting in electrons into each band. This is energy band. We will put energy bands to find how many electrons there are. We will find effective mass. Mass that we should use effectively simply from the curvature and so on. And then we can use Newton's law. We did all the quantum mechanics and so on, but at the end we want to use Newton's law to just simply calculate how electron moves and using the mass and so on. Okay? So that's the end of this electrons in solid vectors.